Welcome to Qt Widgets and More. In the previous episode, we started the journey of implementing the proxy model that flipped the rows in a table. We missed two signals from the underlying model. We missed acting on those two signals, namely those relating to layout change. Watch this episode to learn how to implement them. So reviewing the application that we had last time, it worked out pretty well. I could update random items, as you see here. I could remove or add rows. So here's a removing of rows. But what didn't work out was when I selected something and I clicked the header, the selection was gone. And the problem with that, or the problem that we saw was that I called reset model whenever the underlying model, my source model, it told me that the layout was changed. This episode will see the proper implementation for layout about to be changed and layout changed. Before we go and look at the source code, we need to understand a crucial part of the model view infrastructure, namely the model index list. If you ever just implemented table and list models, you might not have seen more than they are containers for row and columns. But if you've done a tree model implementation, you will have realized that in that model index, you store a pointer to the underlying data structure. At least that's one way of doing it and the most common way of doing it. Therefore, the model indexes themselves have some relationship to the underlying data structure. And it's actually rather dangerous to store model indexes around because the underlying data structure might have changed. For example, a simple example, if I had a table with a number of rows in and I inserted something before that model index would refer to the wrong row number all of a sudden. So you're not allowed to store model indexes around. If you really must, you need to convert them into persistent model indexes. And persistent model indexes to a model, the model itself knows about these. And whenever something changes, the model will go to the list of persistent model indexes and update them. So if you have a persistent model index, it might feel like you just have a value of a class, but really underneath it has a pointer back on it. Actually, the model has a pointer into this model index so that it knows to update it. And that's what we'll be doing now in the source code. We need to update our persistent model indexes whenever the layout change. The strategy is like this. Whenever the about to change signal comes in, we'll go and get persistent model indexes for all the persistent model indexes we have. And then whenever the layout changed comes in, we'll go and map those persistent model indexes in the underlying model, those that we just got, we'll convert them to persistent model indexes in our model and call the appropriate API on the Qt, the QAbstracts proxy model class to indicate that, hey, these proxy models, these model indexes has changed. Let's split this in two parts. That's the before and after part. So before anything changes in the source model, the source model will tell me, hey, I'm about to change the layout. Layout about to be changed. It's the signal that it will call, it'll send out for me to do something. What I need to do now is to ask my superclass, namely the Q abstract item model, about which persistent model indexes are there on me. So my view, or the proxy model or whatever above me, have asked for a number of indexes to be updated whenever something changes. So I need to know which they are. I'll go persistent index list. That will return me a list of such indexes, and I'll remember that here. What I next need to do is to create myself a new list that matches these indexes. But while the indexes is in my domain, in the domain of the proxy model index I'm implementing, what I need now is the counterpart indexes in my source model, because the source model will move things around, but those indexes will be updated when it moves them around. That's the whole idea with the persistent model indexes. So I will go and execute this pretty complex looking code here. What it really just do is that it runs through that list of indexes that I've identified that somebody outside is interested in, and I will call map to source on each of those. So taking the index in the in my domain, mapping it to the an index in the source, well, in the source model's domain, I will wrap that in a Q persistent model index, meaning I basically tell the source model, I'm interested in you updating these indexes whenever they change. Now, I store this information into this M source persistent index for layout change. So that was before anything changed. Now the underlying model is reordering the items. Any persistent model index that I've asked for will be updated when it changes, and then the underlying model will emit the signal layout changed, indicating to me that, hey, everything has changed now. If you need to update something, dear view, it doesn't know that I'm a proxy model. It thinks of me as a view. If you need to update anything, you should go and do that now. So layout changed, go do your work. And my work to do basically boils down to calling this method change persistent index list, where I call that method in my Q abstract item model, where I tell it, hey, these indexes that previously looked like this, they now look like this. And to do that, I run through my list of indexes from a list of persistent indexes from the source model, and I call map from source for these indexes. So they are indexes in my domain now. And that's what I give here. New own persistent indexes, M own persistent indexes for layout change. So that was the before list and the new list. I call that. And the final thing I need to do is to tell my listeners, any views that are on me, hey, I actually am done with this layout change that I announced up here. And you can do whatever you want to do. I also, at the end, I clear these two lists, and I do so not only to be able to reuse them up here when I get in next time, but also to make sure that no energy is spent in the source model to update those persistent indexes that are in that list, because who knows, I might not need them anymore. But Jesper, how do I... Persistent model indexes, I get that. I get that you need to do that. But why here? Layout change? Why not? Why not when rows are inserted? Why not when columns are inserted or rows are removed? We didn't do any of that there. And why not? Why do we need to do it here? And if we didn't need to do it the other places, why not? Why do we need to do it here? Okay, that was quite a few questions. Let me try and answer them in turn. So first of all, why didn't I need to do it there? Because that the superclass did that for us. Actually, it's a Q abstract item model that takes care of that. And I'll show you the code to prove my point in just a second. Second, why do we need to do it? Well, actually, we could have had what I just showed you as a default implementation. That would be good in most situations. I think the reason why we get a chance to do it ourselves is that the models might be super complex, or this code might be super complex, and you wouldn't know, in a generic way at least, how the index would change. I just go and ask for all of the indexes and map them like this. So this could be a good default implementation. But in general, there might be a much better implementation of this. But that's just my guesswork. I'll bet you that in a few versions from now in Qt, there will be a default implementation that looks pretty much like this. Okay, let's get back to the the other signals, the rows about to be inserted and rows inserted, where do the updating of model indexes happening there? Let me show you the code. Remember from last week where we implemented the signals for rows about to be inserted or rows about to be moved or rows about to be removed. We were not allowed ourselves to call those signals or emit those signals. Instead, we had to call a signal called, well, not a signal, a method called beginInsertRows in reaction to rows about to be inserted. And the reason for that, you can see exactly here. So whenever we call beginInsertRows, it will, on our behalf, emit that signal for rows about to be inserted. But what it also will do is that it will call rows about to be inserted. That's on D, that's a private method that it has, which we have right here. Q abstract item model private, that's a private implementation here for rows about to be inserted. And here you can see that it takes in this code, and I'll let it up to you to read this code carefully. It's in qAbstractItemModel.tpp if you really want to know everything. But what you can see is that it iterates through all the persistent indexes here, and it does append to a list called persistent underscore moved. So whenever I about to insert rows, it will update my indexes this way. That's why you do not need yourself to do anything about persistent model indexes in these methods. But why? For the layout about to be changed? Well, likely because, as I said, that there could be a much more efficient solution than recording every single. It could have been that you had, I don't know why, but it could have been a gigantic table where you had dragged a selection over a huge amount of items and therefore needed to remember a lot of those. I don't know, but that's likely the reason. An optimization. No default implementation. I'm sure it will come in due time. And that's it for our small mini series on implementing a QAbstracts proxy model subclass. As I started out saying, you likely do not want or need all of this unless you are implementing a general purpose library. Most of the time, you might get by with just calling, as we saw previous episode, begin reset and end reset on your, or begin reset model, I think it's called, on whenever the layout about to be changed signal is emitted. In any case, you hadn't learned bad practices from me, remember? And until next time, have a great time.
Would you like to start learning profiling and debugging properly? Then have a look at our highly rated training courses on kdab.com.